Alrighty. Well, my name is Caleb Tassi. This is Downpour. This is a band we just created, so we hope you guys enjoy some of the songs we're doing. A couple of them are originals, some of them you know. We just hope that we'll be able to lead you and let this the Holy Spirit come in. So right now let's start in prayer and let's just give the glory to God. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time of gathering, Lord. Right now we just want to give everything and all to you. Whatever we maybe have done today, Lord, that we just thank you. We thank you for providing this place. Right now let's just cast everything to the side, Lord, and we just want to give everything and all to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Worthy, 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 oh, this is amazing grace.
the spirit yet? So this is an original. This one's called Trust.
Trust in you, I live for you, you're everything.
thirsty. To the fountain, dip your heart in the stream of life, let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of His mercy. As deep cries out to deep, let's sing it. Another original. This one's called All I Need Is Jesus.
Mm-hmm. fill us up. All I need is Jesus. Sin is in my heart, but he died on the cross. All I need is Jesus. He gave his life for all, and we have not forgotten. Lives to say, your word is true to those who may not know of you. That you are Jesus. All I need is Jesus. Love without conditions, his grace will fill us up. In my heart, but he died on the cross. All I need is Jesus. He gave his life for all, and we have not forgotten.
Let us shout.
And I will shout. His grace will fill us up. All I need is Jesus. Sin is in my heart, but he died on the cross. All I need is Jesus. He gave his life for all, and we have not forgotten.
Next one is another original, but right now we're also going to pray for the tithe that we just know we're doing this for the Lord, and we want to be sure that, you know, if we want more of this, if we want, you know, all these nice things going on, I know this church has been blessed with the remodeling that they're doing and whatnot, and it's just such a blessing. So, dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for being able to give us such a nice, beautiful place to perform at, personally for us as well, Lord. Just a place to worship you and give everything and all to you. We want to pray for, as the offering goes around, Lord, that we just think about you and everything that you do for us. Thank you. better. Lord, we need you. Lord, we need you. Lord, we need you. Right here and now, let's come together. I'll step forward now, Lord, I'm a sinner. We give our hearts, Lord, please make them better. He's right here. love, He'll rescue us. He's here, He's here, He's here now. He's here, He's here, He's here now. Lord, we thank you for this time of worship. We know you're here, Lord. We know you're filling up this room. Right now, we just want to pray for the study. We're just able to learn your word. Equip ourselves for the battle that may come. Maybe we're going through some spiritual warfare right now, Lord. We want to pray for that too. We want to equip ourselves as we go out into the world and maybe teach somebody else, Lord. Be able to witness to them for you. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, we thank God for such a precious, awesome, ministering worship band tonight. So thank you, Caleb. And Caleb, want to tell them the name of your band?
Our name is Downpour, and we are doing a, on the third Sunday of every month, we'll be doing a performance at my house across the street from La Habra High School, and that's going to be at 3 as well.
So every week?
Every month.
Oh, every month. Okay. Wow.
So thank you very much, everybody.
How encouraging. Thank you, guys. Now, that one song, though, about Jesus, okay, I know they're all about Jesus, but that one song, it was like a 1960s or 70s song, kind of, but yet it was, like, really, it was good. It was, like, really catchy. Let's put those words back up there. Don't leave yet. Okay, so, like, that one song that was original, and it had all of those words, and it was kind of, what's the name of it?
That right one Jesus right song.
Let's come together.
Yeah. We have We Need You.
Yeah, We Need You.
Just did.
I think We Need You.
We Need You.
Yeah. Let's see. We got to see that. There's some fun things there. It was kind of a fun song, but it was like Jesus and Jesus, Jesus, We Need You.
Oh, let's see here. Okay. All I Need Is Jesus.
What is it? All I need is Jesus. That's it. Okay, let's try that one. Let's bring that one up. Okay. Let's get there. All I Need Is Jesus. And I think that's all we need, right? All I need is Jesus, love without conditions. Okay. Now, what I want you guys to do, okay, is I want you guys to gather together right here as a little choir, okay? Come on over here, right here, without your microphones. Okay, I want you guys to all stand. And we only sang it one time, so you guys, you know, just didn't learn it. But you guys, I heard you, you're trying to sing it, because I was trying to sing it too, okay? So I want to do not all the long chorus parts, but just the fun parts, okay? So all I need is Jesus, and then right after that, and it gets into the da-da-da-da-da, whatever. Okay, so let's try it. Let's try it doing that. Let's have some fun, okay? Here we go. So starting off with All I Need Is Jesus. Come on, Caleb.
All I need is Jesus, love without conditions. His grace will fill us up. All I need is Jesus, sin is in my heart. But he died on the cross. All I need is Jesus. He gave his life for all. And we have not forgotten.
Okay, let's go. Let's do that one more time. Let's try it, you guys. Okay, one more time. But, wait. Now we need a little bit of extra help. Okay. And then I need everybody that doesn't have knee problems or hip problems to jump out of the seat and come and get real tight in the front here so we can all sing it together, because I want to hear the way it really is supposed to sound. Okay? So here we go. Let's hear the way it's really, really supposed to sound. Okay, here we go. Come on. Okay. Let's all try it, you guys. This is fun. Was that good or what? That's fun, right? Gotta have some fun at church.
Ready? All I need is Jesus. Love without conditions, His grace will fill us up. All I need is Jesus, sin's in my heart, but He died on the cross. All I need is Jesus, He gave His life for all, and we
have not forgotten. One more time. All I need is Jesus. Love without conditions. His grace will fill us up. All I need is Jesus. Sin is in my heart, but he died on the cross. All I need is Jesus. He gave his life for all, and we have not forgotten. All right.
Amen. Thank you.
Okay.
All right.
Excellent.
Great job, everybody.
Thanks, Scott.
All right. Now you guys know how it sounds with a big choir. Okay. Thanks, choir. All right. I've always wanted to be a choir director. No, I'm just kidding. Can you imagine? I really have never thought of that in my entire life. But, you know, a couple of things I do want to share before I get into the book of Revelation chapter 20 tonight and tell you everything that's going to happen for the rest of the history of humanity, okay, and into eternity. One thing I was thinking of, as I was thinking about my ministry and First Love Calvary Chapel and just the fact that there's a church here, and I was thinking about this particular church building that we're in. Now, do you know that a lot of churches don't have church buildings? Now, there's a lot of churches that have really rich church buildings, humongous church buildings, but every church came about for a reason, okay? Some people, because everybody was striving in the church and they were forcing everybody to give so much of their income, and they ended up with this big building because everybody was forced into forced labor, okay? And it was a slave driving machine to get the church building going. So you have churches that are gorgeous out there, but people were slaves to put it there. Then you have churches that, you know, maybe came in the 1950s, probably a lot of the churches in the U.S. You see all these buildings, 50s, 40s, you know, that kind of thing. And, you know, a time in history, things were cheaper, people were working, you know, and all that stuff. And people tied to their churches at that time in history. And people were putting, you know, money into, hey, we got to have a church building. And so there's all kinds of reasons why there are church buildings. There's bad reasons and there's good reasons, okay? And so every church that you drive past, you go, oh, that's a neat church building. Have you ever noticed like a really neat looking church building? But you have to picture, did it get here by the grace of God and people praying and wanting to have a building and God providing? Or did it get there through striving and all kinds of begging? And, you know, like, how did it get there? So probably we'll say 50-50. 50% of the churches are here through begging, and 50% of the church buildings are here through the Lord, you know, helping people bring it about. And so, you know, the idea of having a place is a nice thing, right? I mean, you rent, and oftentimes people that rent will hope to own because you want a place that you can call your own. And so when you finally do get a place, whether it's a place that you rent and the Sunday school teachers don't have to carry in a plastic bin of their Sunday school supplies every week and everything's just there in the cupboard for you or something, there's kind of a rest that comes to that, hey, we have it easier. Sometimes when there's a little bit of a rest in something, there's also a laxivity, right, that can get into that, where people are like, you know, everything's just supposed to be there, somebody else provides it, and it's almost like I do the bare minimum. That can happen too. And so church buildings are a blessing, and they've had them ever since the beginning of the church. They first went from house to house, and they rented space at the temple, and they rented an upper room, and they would do all that stuff, you mean enough for 120 people one time. So Christians have been renting things forever, but even like right during that first century and beyond, there's church buildings they've undug in Israel. And so there's church buildings that have been around for actually thousands of years. And people have, you know, put money into church buildings to have something nice. Because, you know, you have a house, you want to have nice carpeting, you want to have nice, you know, nice living room, nice TV, whatever. And so sometimes the church can be a reflection of what we want and what God gives us too. And so thinking about this place, okay? Now, this place right here. I was thinking because one of the sisters called and reminded me to put into the bulletin, which I did today. I don't know if it went through, but hopefully it went through. I was driving, yes, doing a bulletin announcement while I was driving. And you have to do it on our church app. And then I looked, and I'm going, oh, I hope that went through. But anyway, and the sister reminded me that, you know, parking in the back is for the elderly, for the sick, for those that have surgery, for those that are, you know, disabled, because there's very few spaces, you know, because we're uptown Whittier. And primarily, except on Wednesday night, right? But then primarily, you know, Sunday morning, we've got that whole parking lot across the street. Behind the restaurant there, there's whole city parking lot across the street. Now, I want to tell you something about that city parking lot. One of the negative things of this church, anybody want to know negativity about this church? Secret negativity. One of the negative things about this church is parking. Now people would like it if they could just park in front of their church and just go into church. But this one, you know, it doesn't always work like that. I mean, if you've got to get a parking spot on the street or whatever, it's not comfortable. It's not easy, but you know, hey, it's worth it if you want to be here. And so I prayed for across the street. Now, even Mr. Ed back there at Sound, Pastor Ed, he knows that I asked one time if you can check and see if they'll rent that to us across the street, this open land over there, if they'll just rent it to us for parking. And the answer, of course, was no. But prior to that, I was praying for that landlord, just grant us some extra parking. And so I was praying for this extra parking, not to picture that the city would build a temporary parking lot, and for the city, temporary means several years, parking lot that we will get to enjoy. I mean, that there's not a three-hour limit on Sundays. And we're going to have our men's conference on Saturday, and there's not a three-hour limit on Saturday. I was all worried about that we're going to have all the guys in here for the men's conference. I'm going to say, now go move your cars, now come back in. But they don't have to move their cars. And the Lord gave us a parking lot. Now, I will tell you something. There used to be a grocery store over there across the street. I used to sit in that parking lot, the previous parking lot before the recent parking lot. And I would sit in that parking lot at the grocery store while it was a grocery store. And this was a YMCA. And neither one of them were for sale. And I would just be like, Lord, you know, that would be so neat if you would just give us both of these buildings. And I even, you know, drew a little bullseye around it on a map. And, you know, like, Lord, it's just a little dot in the city of Whittier on the face of the planet Earth. It's just a speck of sand in the midst of the universe, you know. You know, Lord, just if you would just, like, give us this little place, you know. And I prayed for that across the street, and I prayed for this. This is years ago, okay. Now, years ago, God did give us this, which is an interesting thing. And then all of a sudden we get to have parking over there. So you never know what the Lord, if we want to say, has up his sleeves, because he doesn't have sleeves probably, but you know, if he, what the Lord has up his sleeves for us. And so it's pretty exciting. Now let me backtrack a little bit further. We were in a little building on Whittier Boulevard. You have Bob Downey Paint on the corner of Broadway and Whittier Boulevard. A few buildings down is a little square church building, okay? At that little square church building, it was, I think, some sort of other repair shop prior to us, and prior to that, it was a bar. And we started our church, our first church services, in that little square building there, a few doors down from Bob Downey Paint. And then we started having concerts, which, you know, kind of a concert, right, tonight for you guys. And we started having concerts here at the YMCA. There was one concert, I remember, we had 14 people at the concert. Now, we ended up later on having concerts of 900 and 1,000 and stuff like that. Like, I mean, imagine that many people in this building, okay. But we had this concert, and the band, and I you know, was leading them to salvation, and there were 14 people in there, and like 14 people came to Christ. I'm going, okay, you are receiving the Lord? Okay, you're receiving the Lord? And the band later told me, I thought you were lying. I thought you were faking it until I opened my eyes, and I saw their hands were all raised. Because, like, why would there be a concert and only 14 people come and all 14 people become Christians? But, meaning, that's pretty amazing, isn't it? That God works in a lot of different ways. I mean, he's just an amazing God. But when we were in that little small building, We came over here. We had men's and women's Bible studies that we would divide up into different rooms. Then we, I felt like, you know what? We need to get out of this little church building over here. It wasn't really a church building. It was an old bar. But we need to get out of this old bar on Whittier Boulevard if we want to go somewhere as a church. And so I'm thinking, you know, we have the trailer in the back, and the trailer in the back is our Sunday school, and people are breaking into it almost every week and even defecating and things like that. And you're like, oh my gosh, this is horrifying to deal with. You know, but this is Whittier, right? And so Whittier hasn't changed much. But anyway, so we were dealing with all of that, even though this one guy, I'll tell you what, this one guy that we would try to bring into church, and he was a drunk, and he would always hang out in the back of the church, and I mean, just always, not a drunk, but a drunk, one of the Whittier winos, we'll say, that was just like beyond repair, and used to always share the Lord with him, and you know, years later, he was cleaned up and following the Lord. He didn't end up attending our church, but I would see him sometimes at the YMCA and things like that, and he was just so happy in Jesus. And you would never imagine this street person that you saw like this being an absolutely normal person, but like a serious Christian. And it was like such a contrast. But it's amazing the impact we have as individuals on people, and part of that contributing factor of what God's doing in their life. And so, but I knew that we couldn't go anywhere. I mean, people would come to the church and go, well, this is a cute little church and a nice little Bible study, but not necessarily a place I want to bring my family. You know what I'm saying? So like a hindrance. It was a hindrance. And so then I came over here. Now, there was hindrances here as well, you know. We would have our toddler room over there, and it was the Y. And as soon as you turn on the lights, you'd see cockroaches just run in every direction. So this was also an interesting place to have church at. And so we had our hurdles. We had our hurdles over the year, But while we were here, they decided to move, and they decided to build a building. Hey, welcome. They decided to build a building over there, and I'm like, okay, Lord, what are we going to do, you know? And so the Lord worked it out, and check this out. Okay, see this whole building? Okay, how much do you guys pay for rent for a building? I mean, for a house, whatever, you know? I mean, like, at least for a one-bedroom, $1,200 or something, right? And so we got this for $400 a month. Think of that, you guys. Think of that. Is the Lord good? $400 for this entire place. Now, electricity, like I think air conditioning was $3,000 or $4,000 a month, and you know, so the guy was telling me, well, we're gonna give it to you for $400 a month, but repairs and electricity and all this kind of stuff, so I don't know if you're gonna be able to swing it, you know. And I'm like, you know, I don't understand money and reality and life or anything. I'm going, no, we'll be able to do this. I have no idea. And you know what? We never got one extra red penny that came in, and somehow, some way, bills were always paid here when we took over renting this place. And do you know, I think and don't fault me in this, because heaven will tell you when it happens, but I believe it was 20 years. We didn't change a bulb, a light bulb, for 20 years. Okay? Okay, I'm getting there. Let me think. I'm trying to figure this out for a second. No, I'm wrong. We didn't change a light bulb for 10 years. Okay? So I doubled that. I wanted to make it sound good. No, I'm just kidding. No, my memory was faulty. But 10 years, literally, we did not change a bulb. Even the bulbs out in the front of the church, never changed those bulbs. And all of a sudden, when they started going out, then we changed them in a year, in 2 years, and then they were just kind of going out all the time. But 10 years, nothing. Like, you know how the Bible talks about the children of Israel in the wilderness, their shoes didn't wear out? You know it says that? I'm telling you, it was weird stuff like that, that, you know, you don't change a bulb. And I was thinking about that because I was in the pool area, which is our future banquet room, which has still sat there, a swimming pool, sits in this building. Okay, Olympic-sized pool. And I was in there yesterday, and the lights were on. And I was realizing, you know what? These lights are on. Now, obviously, we don't use that room, so the lights aren't going to necessarily go dead. But I mean, but we had been in the building. So if we were taking the amount of time owning the building, in the building, 20, maybe 20-something years, those bulbs have never gone out. Now, doesn't mean we haven't changed other bulbs. But I'm telling you that the Lord has maintained. You know how houses fall apart and pipes break, and we've been through some of that here, but nothing tragic. Now, of course, they always say, it's when you say it. Okay, boom, everything's going to break next week. Okay, but I'm telling you that the Lord has blessed us being here. And I'm thankful for a place. I don't understand why that gas station is closed down next door and we don't get that land. I don't understand that. I don't know if the Lord's going to have across the street, we're going to build a new building over there someday. I don't know if, you know, somebody's going to walk in with $25 million, we're going to build a new building on Whittier Boulevard or what. I have no idea, right? None of us know. But you know, God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And God is exciting. And God is good. And so whether it be our own personal lives and looking to the Lord of the miraculous, looking to the Lord of the surprises, and the Lord of the provision, and the Lord of the one that helps us, I have seen God help us. I mean, absolutely, Uptown Whittier. I don't like the fact that somebody etched all over our glass in our front window, you know, of our doors. I don't like that kind of stuff. But, hey, we have front door windows. You know what I'm saying? Like, God has blessed us. So I'm very thankful, and I'm very excited for the Lord and what he has done and what he will do. And I hope that we all have that excitement for the Lord. I'd like to also, before I teach tonight, and I know I've taken a long time explaining that to you, but I kind of wanted to bring you there. You know what? No, I didn't. I want to bring you back further. I want to bring you all the way back to, a long time ago, in 1986. That's where I want to bring you to. And I was in the country of Lebanon, and I had a dream that I was preaching in the Whittier Theater, which was on the corner of Hadley and Milton. And when I was preaching in that theater, the theater was closed down, but I was preaching in there. And when I got back, I was dating Maureen at the time, and I went up to the box office of the Whittier Theater, and I said, because it was closed down in my dream, and I thought, well, maybe this is a sign from the Lord. Maybe it's going to close or something. And I went up to the box office, and I said, by any chance, are you guys planning on closing this theater? And the girl said, well, we just found out today. How did you know? You know, they'd just gotten through with a meeting about it. And I don't know what I told her, actually. I don't remember. But I was like going, whoa. I was like tripping on it. Wouldn't you trip on that? I was tripping on it. And I was just like interested, like, wow, this must mean something. Now, I thought that it meant that we're supposed to start a church there. And so we got a group of young people. We marched around the building for 7 days. On the seventh day, we marched around 7 times. And we had one of our guys play the trumpet, and he blew the trumpet like the Jericho March. And within 6 months or a year, I don't remember the exact amount of time, but the building was gone. We did the wrong Bible story. So if you do, like Jericho, if you do march around something for 6 times, the 7th time, you go 7 times, and you blow the trumpet, the building disappears. It's in the Bible, and we saw it happen. I'm telling you, we saw it happen. So then, what does that mean? Does that mean that we were not able to do what God wanted us to do? No, because the theater, it said Whittier Theater. And it meant Whittier. It meant assembly, a place of assembly in Whittier, and people gathering and me preaching. That's what it meant. And our first building was on Whittier Boulevard. Our second building was on Hadley. That one was on the corner of Hadley and Whittier Boulevard. So the Lord knows where we're supposed to be, what we're supposed to be doing. And this is a good thing. We're having a good thing as Christians. God's got good plans for all of us. And he wants to speak to us. He wants to even speak little words to you when you're waking up in the morning. You know, we are all imperfect beings. We are all problematic, and we all have these little sinful things about us, right? But the Lord speaks to us. He doesn't just let us go. He speaks to us. Last night, I had a brother teach the men's study. And I didn't want to teach it. You ever feel like that? You just don't want to go to work. I went to work. I was there. But I didn't want to teach it. I just want to have somebody else teach it. And you know what he taught about? He taught about condemnation. And he was saying that he just is always tempted toward feeling condemned. His whole life, he always just feels condemned. And he gave a lot of good scriptures and some good stories. And I didn't know that about that brother. I didn't know that what he was sharing in his teaching was, you know, that he understood it was what he went through. And, but God gave him stability in his life. God gave him belief system and scriptures to help him be stable as a Christian. And I just believe that God gives us things to stand upon. So if you feel weak, if you feel broken, if you feel like your life isn't, you know, just where you want it to be, all I can say is trust in the Lord. Trust in the Lord. Don't ever let go of the Lord. Just know that the Lord's got something to say to you. He's got something to give to you to hold on to, okay? Just that little word to hold on to. I know just the other day I got, and I'm not going to even say what they were because they were my words, but he gave me a few words. And I thought, wow, okay, I couldn't even think of these words because I don't really totally even know these words. I had to look it up and figure it out. And I knew what it meant. I knew what the Lord was saying. And just that the Lord doesn't let us go. The Lord doesn't let us go our way. The Lord doesn't let us do anything without undergirding us and speaking to us about things. And this Saturday, we have a men's conference. I need, Robert, you to make sure every guy on the way out gets a card for the men's conference. It's going to be in here, in this room right here. We've got 6.5 guys speaking, okay? And we've got my son Elijah, who tonight is speaking at Cal Poly Pomona. He's got like a tour of 6 colleges he's going to speak at. We've got myself speaking. We've got Pastor Sean speaking. We've got Richard Christensen from our church here speaking. Yes, your dad. Come on, cheer your dad on. Come on, he deserves it, Richard Christensen. Okay, we've got Fish Figueroa speaking. And we've got this guy named Brian Flores from Freedom Something Church in Orange County. And then we've got a friend named Chris Plant that will be, he's a doctor, young guy, but doctor, and he'll be sharing about the kind of the psychological and mental effects of being able to get up after you've fallen down and have people that you can talk to about your struggles and things like that. And so he'll share a little bit. And of course, I'm going to share. And we're going to have lunch. We're going to have some giveaways. Where's Raul? Raul's going to do some giveaways. And we're just going to have a good time Saturday. But here's what I need. And I really am going to teach the whole Bible study tonight in half an hour, okay? I need Bobby, you, to go to my first Facebook page, my Facebook page. It's church Facebook page, which is First Love CC Whittier, or my Facebook page, which is John K. Schaefer. You have to do the K in there. I'll accept you as a friend. Church, mine, or if you're in Brothers Seeking the Lord, I have a group page with about 500 brothers called Brothers Seeking the Lord. And share the flyer from one of those pages if you'll do that for me. Because I really, see, when we do men's conferences here, we're not a big church and we don't do things big. I mean, we're not like real super professional, right? So we'll get maybe, I think the last one we had 70 guys. We've had 80 guys. We've had maybe up to 120 guys. But we've never had 200 guys. So, you know, I don't know how many guys are going to come, but I want you to share to get guys to come. I'm going to drive my dad that morning, okay? And so try to get your family, different guys to come, and just to hang out all day. Because the studies are all about the internal and fleshly and all the warfare that a man goes through, specifically. And the falls throughout his life that he goes to through. And how he picks himself up, and how others pick him up, and how he picks others up, and how God picks him up. Okay? And so it's all about getting back up, falling down, and getting back up. And just really exhausting that, looking at that topic. So I want to pray for that right now, and then we're going to pray for the study at the same time, and then I'm going to totally run through the study with you from Revelation chapter 20. Lord, we come before you. We thank you, Lord God, for an opportunity tonight, Lord God, to pray. And we pray for Saturday, because Saturday, Lord, is just a couple of days away. And we pray, Lord, that you would just bring guys here. Lord, whether it's the food that brings them, whether it's the fact that they might get a free Starbucks card or something, or a guitar that gets them here, or Lord, whether it be that they just want to hear the word, or just that the topic sparks them because of what they're going through. Whatever it is that you're going to get them here, Lord, I pray that you would help the people here to invite people on Saturday, Lord. We pray blessings, blessings, blessings over our men's conference. We pray it would be unlike any conference ever seen. And we pray, Lord God, that it would be so helpful that people would just be walking out as if they had been blown away by God being here in full force. In Jesus' name, amen. And one last comment. When Caleb prayed something to the effect of the Lord filling the room, okay, now check this out. Look around you. Here's some space. There's some space. There's some space. And, of course, in the back, there's space. A little bit of space right in there, right? Now, imagine God. Say if God was like a ghostly, invisible, blobbish, you know, misty, you know, the presence of God just, boom, just settling down in all of those, like plumping down in all of these open spaces, like God filling the room. Okay, yes, my mind does go crazy when people say things like that. I'm picturing God like filling the room. And you know what? Okay, check this out. On Wednesday nights, you know, we have a limited amount of people here, right? Sunday nights too. But it was like, it doesn't matter. Because God is filling the room. So wherever there's not a person, we must decrease, so he must increase. It's like we get that much more of God. So, you know, so if somebody's gone, God is filling that space. He's filling this room. I love it. So I just wanted to say, based on what Caleb said there, I totally got that. Now tonight, Revelation chapter 20. Revelation chapter 20, verses 7 through 10. Let's go ahead and pray. And some of the young people are going to the high school room right now. Father, we ask you to speak to us, Lord God. Minister to us. And let the word of God ring loud and true in our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Revelation chapter 20, verse 7. It says, "Now when the 1,000 years have expired, Satan will be released from his prison and will go out to deceive the nations which are in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together for battle, whose number is as the sand of the sea. And they went up on the breadth of the earth and surrounded the camp of the saints and the beloved city. And fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. The devil who deceived them was cast into the lake of fire with brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever." Okay, so we start off, and I want you to see verse 7. It says, "When the 1,000 years have expired." The 1,000-year reign of Christ. Jesus Christ comes back tonight, takes the church to be with him. Then all hell breaks loose on the world. There's 7 years of tribulation and the devil deceiving the inhabitants of the world. Then all the saints come back with Jesus. 10,000s times 10,000s and thousands upon thousands come back with Jesus, all on white horses and all with harps. Okay? We all come back with Jesus, and then we set up the kingdom of God on the earth. Kingdom of God lasts for 1,000 years. But during that 1,000 years, all of the nations and the cities have been rebuilt. Everything that God destroyed during the tribulation period for the wrath of God upon the world, everything destroyed is rebuilt. All the cities, all the countries, everything's rebuilt. There's billions of people on the planet Earth again, in addition to however many people there are that are living in their new bodies on the Earth. And at the end of that time, it says, when that 1,000 years has expired, it says that Satan is released from prison. Now, why? And how long of a period of time? Is it another 7 years? Why is Satan released from prison? And it says that he's released from prison to deceive the nations of the world again. So the first thing that you've got to see is that there's no Satan for 1,000 years, because verses prior to that say that an angel with a great chain locked him up and threw him into the bottomless pit for 1,000 years. So he's away. He's off the scene. He cannot deceive. So during that 1,000 years, all of the non-Christians that are born and all of the people that we are ruling and reigning over as believers, they've still got a sinful nature, but they're not being tempted by the devil. They're just being tempted by their own sinful nature and by the allurements of the fleshly things that affect them, that are around them. And so we're able to counsel them and direct them through their troubles, but without having to deal with the devil as part of the equation. But at the very end of that time, these people are going to know a devil that they've never known before. And you would think, having Jesus in the flesh, ruling and reigning out of Jerusalem, even though there's billions of people on the earth, people could still take a plane and fly over to Jerusalem and see where Jesus is ruling and reigning. So it's going to be, you know, a regular world for some people, and for us, we're going to have our new bodies. But yet those people are still going to be deceived to create a rebellion against Jesus, to encamp armies around Jerusalem, to think that, like Satan, I will ascend above the stars of God, to think that Satan, after 1,000 years in a cave of wonders, a bottomless pit, that was Aladdin's lamp, but you would think that after 1,000 years of him having time to think about things, that Satan would finally come to the conclusion, this is a mess, what am I doing? I'm not going to deceive people anymore. I mean, obviously God's going to win. But according to Scripture, when it comes to certain kinds of deceitful people, it says that they really don't get better, they get worse. And I want you to look at a Scripture that shows that right now in the book of Timothy. So turn yourself to the book of Timothy, and specifically, we'll say 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 13 and 14. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 13 and 14. In fact, we'll just stick with verse 13. It says, but evil men and imposters will grow worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. So if men can grow worse and worse, and they're deceiving others, and they themselves are personally deceived, then how much more could the devil grow worse and worse? I mean, you think, how much worse could the devil be? But during that 1,000 years, he's not loving God. You've heard the phrase, never Trumper. Anybody ever hear that phrase? And nowadays they call somebody who wants nothing to do with our president, they call them a never Trumper. And well, similar to that phrase, okay, the way that phrase is used, is the devil is a never Godder. You know, I mean, there's just never, no matter what, I am not going to submit nor to follow God nor to believe his ways. He's a never Godder. He's just not going to go that direction, no matter what. So after 1,000 years of thinking, 1,000 years of being in prison, and he gets out and he just does what he does. And what does the devil do? The devil deceives. He's a father of lies. And now you wonder, though, in God's judicial system of eternity, why? Why does the devil have another chance? I thought the cross of Christ triumphed over the devil. Why would he get another chance at the end of the 1,000 years? But I'll tell you that angels, Satan's an angel, angels are not humans. God has a different plan for humans and the way that humans will be judged. And then he had this plan on the way that Satan would be judged. And he has given Satan much time. And much time, number one, because God is proving to even to all of us and to all the angels that evil will never triumph over good. No matter how many chances, no matter how long it tries to prevail, evil will never prevail over good, ever. So God proves that. But then you would wonder, then, is God complicit in working with the devil? And you're saying, I wouldn't wonder that. Well, no, but you might if you were kind of a thinking person that was thinking things all the way through and going, well, God's allowing the devil another chance. God's allowing the devil to deceive people. God created Lucifer. God knew that Lucifer would fall. God knew that people would actually, the human race would sin, and sin would enter the human race. And so is God complicit with the devil? Is God equal in the wrongdoing? Is God equal in the crimes of the devil because God keeps letting him out? You know, I mean, would you let somebody that's an absolute criminal out of prison if you knew that they were going to go and they're going to mess everybody up? I mean, what, you know, because people even now, they look at judges that do that as a bad judge, and they they judge them, even though they're going according to certain laws of the land. But if you're going to judge God, you have to base it upon what the facts that are presented are. And the facts that are presented is in the book of Numbers, there's a scripture that says that God is not a man in Numbers chapter 23, verse 19. Numbers 23, verse 19 says that God is not a man that he should lie. So the devil's a liar, but God doesn't lie. So that's just a bottom line for God all the time, is that God doesn't lie. Then it says in the book of James that God is not tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anybody else with evil. So then you think, but yes, that's true, but the devil tempts people, and God's using the devil to train us for war, how to use our sword and our shield, and he's allowing the devil to do all this, so he's using the devil. So then isn't God to be faulted because he's using the devil to train us? Let me explain something. Bigger than God using the devil, and even bigger than the evil and the lies of the devil, is bigger is the wisdom of God. Bigger is the power of God. Bigger is the grace of God. And God's judicial system is much bigger than our human minds can fathom in his eternal mind and his omniscient mind. It's just that God has a plan on what he is doing in humans' lives, in angels' lives. And so no matter what we would try to do to bring God down and humanize him and go, well, if he were a judge and he did it like this, and then God must be equal to that, I'm telling you that you can't stand there in judgment of God, because God doesn't tempt, God doesn't lie, and God isn't just using evil. God is showing that he's more powerful than evil. God is showing that the devil is very minute and very small compared to who God is and how powerful God is. And so all you can say then is that I don't understand it completely, but that God definitely has a plan. And the plan at the end of the end of the end, at the end of the 1,000 years when they've expired, is to release the devil from his prison. Now, the devil's locked away for 1,000 years. In the bottomless pit, the place where all of those other demonic beings that are released upon the planet Earth during the book of Revelation are stored. Then there's also a place called the grave, the place of the dead, Hades, or hell. And that place is also called a prison. And there's a scripture, if you were taking notes, and it's in the book of Peter. And in that particular verse in the book of Peter, it says this. It says in 1 Peter 3:19, by whom also he went and preached to the spirits in prison. That Jesus, when he died on the cross, he went down to the heart of the earth, place where the spiritual world of the dead is, and all the people that had died during Noah's time, the billions of people that lived on the planet that rejected God and went to this place, he preached to them. So they were preached. So those people in prison, some that were on Abraham's bosom side, they got out. Some that were just on the bad side, they heard the gospel, as somebody who would be judged as hearing the gospel. But the point is that God uses, just like man uses a judicial system and uses a prison, God has these places that are temporary. Hell, is hell eternal or is hell temporary? Which one? What do you think? According to the Bible, hell is temporary. Hell is just a temporary holding place for the place of the dead, that it's a prison. And then everybody's brought out of hell in the end. They're put before God's white throne judgment. And the books are opened. And each one is judged according to their works. The ones who did the work of believing, that's pretty easy work, right? Those ones enter into the joy of the Lord and into the things that God has prepared for those who love him. But those that didn't receive Jesus Christ, they get thrown into what's called the lake of fire. Now, the lake of fire is eternal, not hell, but the lake of fire is eternal. And so the book of Revelation, chapter 20, chapter 21, and chapter 22, all three chapters do talk about this lake of fire and it being eternal. Hell is temporary. Lake of fire is eternal. Hell is a prison. Lake of fire is an everlasting judgment. But obviously, if you were in hell, and even if you get out for a few minutes to, you know, hang out at the white throne judgment, and then you get thrown into the lake of fire, it's still not a happy day for you. You know, even if you have a rest for a moment there standing before God, but you're not going to be happy. And so the devil himself deceives people because he wants people to wander from the truth. He wants people to roam away from what is right, the righteousness of God, the goodness of God, the love of God, a good God. And he wants to have them in his playground, in living within their weaknesses. I think as we've all done at times in our lives and been fooled by ourselves and by the devil himself, and he wants to get us in this realm of being deceived because he doesn't want us to be with God. He's doing everything he can to be against God. He's a never-godder. And so we've got the devil who is deceiving everybody from what they could have to not have that in order to you know, because he's pretty upset and he wants to just bring everybody down with himself. And so nothing's going to change his mind. He's not going to have this reformation after 1,000 years and go, oh, I realize I was wrong. So will the devil one day be saved? And the answer is no. He's not going to one day be saved. And then it goes on in the chapter of Revelation, and I want you to take a look here, chapter 20, and it says in verse 9, well, actually, verse 8, it talks about that he deceived the nations to gather together, and he mentions a couple of cities there, Gog and Magog. Gog and Magog, those are from Ezekiel chapter 38 and 39, and they're mentioned there as cities and places that were going to come against God's people in the last days. But according to this scripture, and I want you to look at it, it says, after the 1,000 years were expired, these nations are going to come against the land of God where Jesus is ruling and reigning out of. I know a lot of people look at, how many of you guys have read through Ezekiel 38 and 39 for prophetic value, and in the back of your mind, you know what I'm talking about when I say Ezekiel 38 and 39, raise your hand right now. If you know what I'm talking about, one, keep it up, two, three, okay. So yeah, not real popular nowadays. The end times isn't necessarily the most popular thing to study nowadays, but Ezekiel 38 and 39, a lot of people think that this war that's talked about happens right before we get taken to heaven in the rapture. Some people think it's the Battle of Armageddon, which the Battle of Armageddon is all nations gathering together, okay, and then they, you know, point their missiles at Christ coming back on his white horse and all the saints coming back with him. But this particular one here, this particular war, is a final war where people are thinking that, you know, we're going to be independent. We don't need Christ ruling out of Jerusalem. As if the devil tempts them. He puts it into their heart. How does the devil gather people together? How does the devil unify people? How does the devil, you know, what does he tell them? What did he tell the angels when he was in heaven and he pulled a third of the angels out of heaven? I mean, he is a master deceiver. And you listen to the devil and you're tricked. And so at this point in time, this is what's happening. The world is listening to the devil. Even though Jesus is physically, the resurrected Christ is physically for 1,000 years ruling and reigning out of Jerusalem in a physical way, whether you went to Jerusalem and saw him or whether you saw him on TV, he's going to be there. And so all the nations come as the sand of the sea, like there's so many people that are against Jesus at this time. I mean, could you imagine the best king that ever ruled and reigned the earth and all the people in their sinful nature are still coming against him? It says in verse 9, it says, and they went up on the breadth of the earth and they surrounded the camp of the saints and the beloved city. Well, I will tell you, though the enemy comes in like a flood and surrounds us, God can raise up a standard against him and protect you. The Bible says that the angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him. So, though the enemy might surround you, I will tell you that God is ultimately surrounding you. And the Bible says, as the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people from this time forth and forevermore. There's a story where Elisha told the servant, his servant, he goes, I'm going to pray that God opens your eyes and you can see. And as the armies were surrounding Jerusalem, he showed him the chariots of God and all the angels surrounding those armies. And so it's good to know that when you feel surrounded, there's a song that we sing, and I don't know if I'm going to say the words right, Brian, but it says, whenever I'm surrounded by you. Is that the right words? Oh, there we go. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. Like, there's a scripture in the book of Psalms, and it says that the bees have surrounded me, but God uses them as thorns to crackle in the fire. It says that in the Bible, okay, about the bees. And imagine a beehive of killer bees coming at you, a swarm, all around you, and they're on you. Oh, that's scary. It's scary being surrounded. But you just remember, you know, the Lord just can squish those bees. Remember that the Lord is surrounding you. That's a bigger surrounding. The angel of the Lord encamp around you. Chariots of God are around you. Mountains surround Jerusalem. So that's like the Lord surrounding his people. The Lord is around you. So yes, the armies might come in like a flood and surround God's holy city and God's beloved people and even the Lord Jesus Christ himself. But greater is he that is in us. And so then what happened there? In verse 9 it says, and fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. Not John, Jesus' disciple, who said, let's call fire down from heaven. Not Elijah, who called down fire from heaven on the prophets of Baal or on the king's men that were sent to him. Not anybody else, like the guys in Revelation, the two prophets who call down fire. Mm-mm. This is God bringing down his fiery indignation on the adversaries here. So he's calling down the fire from heaven to devour all of those that are in opposition. And it says in verse 10, the devil who deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone where the beast and the false prophet are. And they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. Now, we're going to be getting to these other scriptures, but for the sake of time tonight, I have them actually all written down, but I obviously cut a half an hour out of my Bible study. But as we go through chapter 21 and 22, there's more scriptures about the lake of fire. And there are scriptures about the Lord wiping away the tears of his people. And there are scriptures about us being in the presence of the Lord forever and ever. Now let me ask you a question. Do you think that when you go to be before the Lord, and it's going to be forever and ever, do you think that that means that it has an ending point and then all of a sudden you're just annihilated and you disappear? Or do you think when God says you have everlasting, eternal life, that it means forever and ever? I mean, just think about that for a moment. What do you believe on that? Do you believe forever and ever just means from generation to generation and at some point it all ends? Well, I'm going to tell you, there are people who believe that hell isn't forever. Obviously, the Mormons don't believe that. Obviously, the Jehovah's Witnesses don't believe in it. And there are actually some Christians who don't believe it as well. But then they'll tell you, but yeah, I believe heaven's forever, but I don't believe hell is forever. But when you look in the book of Revelation and you see it says forever and ever on both sides about eternity for the saints and for those that have not attended to the Lord Jesus Christ, that they are cast into the lake of fire in Matthew chapter 25. They're cast into the lake of fire, which was prepared for the devil and his angels. It wasn't made for humans. But that's what they get because they didn't attend to Jesus in their lives. And so there is a place that's forever and ever. And so even though people would say, well, God's unjust because a loving God wouldn't make people burn like that forever, you know, or whatever, however you want to picture it. And when we say burn, I don't know exactly what it means with fire and a soul and burning. And I don't know. And then it says that they're judged according to their works. So everybody's judged differently as far as eternal judgment. So some people don't have as much severity. Some people have greater severity. What does that look like? I don't know what that looks like in eternity. All I know that even if it's just a lonely existence, to just weeping and gnashing of teeth, to over here where there's fullness of joy in the presence of the Lord and there's, you know, white horses and there's beautiful waterfalls, and there's the rainbow around the throne of God, and all the things that the Bible says of what it's going to look like. Hey, I'll tell you, I know what I want forever and ever. And this Antichrist and this devil and this beast and this, you know, all of them, it says, are thrown into this lake of fire, which is forever and ever. That right there is not a prison. Forever and ever is not a prison. It's like this is a final, final judgment. And then he obviously will never, ever deceive again. But I wouldn't want any of you to ever go to that forever place apart from God. I would want to make sure that you knew that Jesus died on the cross for your sins and that Jesus rose again from the dead and that you were born again and that you knew that you asked Jesus into your heart and you knew that the blood of Jesus Christ gave you a new conscience and washed your sins away. That's the only way to have a blessed life is to have Jesus. It really is the only way. Doesn't mean you have a perfect life. I mean, we all struggle and we all have, you know, need money at times and have problem people in our lives and all that stuff's all normal, okay? But I'd rather have struggles and money problems and cut my arm off. Don't let me cut my arm off tomorrow. But, you know, I'd rather go through all of that and have Jesus and go to heaven than have a forever without God. So let's pray if there's anybody here tonight that doesn't know Jesus in a personal way, okay? Okay, Lord, we just pray, Lord, as we know that the devil's going to be thrown into that lake of fire, which is called the second death. But Lord, I want everybody here to take part in the first resurrection with myself and those that are believers. And so, Lord, if there is just one person, Lord God, that somehow might not make it, and they're just not 100% sure that they've been born again. They're not 100% sure that they've truly, truly repented of their sins and given their heart to Jesus. And I pray right now that you would help them, Lord God, to make a bold moment of their life right now to confess you in a prayer out loud, Lord, in Jesus' name. So raise your hand right now if you'd like to make a prayer out loud of repentance and to repeat a prayer with me and say, Lord, forgive me of my sins. Let your blood cover me, come into my heart. If you want to pray that kind of prayer with me and be a Christian and be sure that you're a Christian, be sure that you're not going to the lake of fire, but you're going to, you know, eternity with God, raise your hand right now. Pray with you. Anybody here need to make that kind of decision? Today is the day of salvation. Do not harden your heart. Raise your hand and I will pray with you and Jesus will do the rest. Anybody here? Say, Pastor John, yes, that's me. I really, really want salvation. I want to go to heaven. I want eternity with God. Okay, if you didn't raise your hand, but you know you need to, come to me afterwards, because sometimes that happens like that. But secondly, if you're a Christian, but what I'm saying puts fear into you, even though you don't know that you have received Christ, but you know you've been backslidden, and you know you want to return to Christ today, this is a secondary altar call saying, return to the Lord. So is there somebody who has drifted and roamed and wandered from the Lord, and but you need to return to the Lord today? You already know it's true. You've already confessed it, but you want to reconfess it because you know you got to get back and get right with God today to walk with him on the earth. Anybody here need to come back to God? Raise your hand. I'll pray for you. Anybody need to come back to the Lord? Today is your day of returning to the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, let's all stand, and let's close with this worship song.
That is voice.
with me. Now great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great. more time.
How great is our God. Sing with me. How great is our God. We'll see how great. How great is our God.
Lord, we thank you for this time of worship. We thank you for this just beautiful study, Lord. Right now, we just want to pray for Traveling Mercies as we're on our way home, that you just keep us safe. We want to pray for the fellowship that we are about to have. Lord, if someone in here needs you, we know you see them. I'm even going through some spiritual warfare myself. But I know that you will take care of it.
How great is our God.
Amen.